Reeler by David Hewson. Narrated by Gemma Whelan. 1. I told them people were hanging round the house. There'd been noises at night, outside in the garden. Once I felt sure they'd come indoors, padding around in the dark while I shivered in my tiny room, single bed shoved up against the door. No one believed me. It wasn't that long after the pandemic. Lots of people went a bit strange, started telling funny stories, seeing funny things. Why wouldn't a 16-year-old schoolgirl called Charlie Mackintosh be one of them? Didn't help that home had fallen to pieces in ways I never understood. Mum and Dad struggled through that long, bleak year, not on bad terms, not on good either. I just tried to stay out of the way as we all struggled to remember what day of the week it was, and if it really mattered. They both worked, long hours, night and day. The warehouse was going crazy, trying to pump out millions of orders from people who couldn't get stuff down the shops. Then one Sunday, Dad packed his bags, kissed me goodbye, said not to worry, and went off to a rented flat in town. It all happened so quickly, he never got to see me crying. Not long after, Rick was making his bacon sarnies in the kitchen. He was their supervisor in the giant warehouse up the road, and went from bossing them around to slipping into Mum's bed so quickly, it felt like a lodger had turned up and found there was only one room to spare. One Saturday in May, when Dad was supposed to come round, someone broke in for real. The door to his shed in our ragged, abandoned garden out back was off its hinges. No one went in there. It was his place alone. He was a big man, tall, burly, Yorkshire-born, though his own father was Scottish, not that I ever knew him. From the pictures I'd seen, though, it was clear Ali Mackintosh inherited his looks and passed them on to me. Unruly ginger hair, broad, speckled face. Dad was shy at heart, even if he looked like a giant who ought to be tossing cabers somewhere. Cheery, usually, apart from that morning of the break-in, when his face was dark with thunder. He told me I'd have to go out for a walk on my own. He had work to do. They hadn't nicked anything, but he needed to make his private sanctuary secure. Mum and Rick had watched from the kitchen, moaning about having to set off to work in cold blow down the road. After they left, Dad, fresh from the night shift in the same place, turned a bit milder, apologetic that he couldn't go out bird-watching like he promised. The shed seemed important to him, not that we had much that was worth anything. Still, it needed fixing or those tow rags would just come back and break in again. Home felt the way the weather did when a storm was brewing, the way school felt now. The country, too. Like everyone else, I'd spent the big lockdown cooped up indoors, wondering when it was coming to an end. Unlike most other people, I didn't really mind. It meant I wasn't at school, getting called all manner of names by the louts who'd latched onto the fact I was ginger. Now most of the immigrants they used to taunt were either going or gone. I could talk to Dad when he was off work, paint the views from our windows and the one half-broken bench seat we had in the garden. Read a lot as well. Eventually, people trooped back to school and work, the pubs opened, those that were still in business. Not that so many wanted to crowd around a bar and talk crap to one another any longer. Time and again, on the telly, on your phone, on buses, people said, life won't go back to normal now, things will never be the same. Not that anyone quite knew what normal was, any more than they could figure out the strange, silent vacuum that had turned up to replace it. We'd all have to be careful from now on, they told us. Wary about who we came close to, especially anyone we touched, which I found quite welcome, if I'm honest. Then there were the solutions hatched up, mostly between a panicky government and some tech firms promising they'd help. ID cards, naturally, and woe betide anyone caught without one. Chasing soft targets, bored folk doing what they shouldn't, when they shouldn't, seemed to be more important to the coppers than banging up robbers and thugs, which didn't help the national mood. Break-ins, school, the ever-present threat the pandemic might just decide to pop its head out of its virus grave and squeal, "Surprise!" The river was a place to forget them all, even if on that particular day Dad couldn't make it. Out there in the open, away from everything, beneath a bright blue summer sky, listening to the quacking on the water and the buzz of dragonflies rising from bulrushes by the edge, I felt briefly free. I'd brought along the easel Dad had bought at Christmas, a box of paints, some brushes and pencils. Halfway through trying to sketch a pair of swans before picking out some watercolours, there was a hard tap on my shoulder, the kind you'd usually get from someone you knew. This was a stranger, so close that, even before I turned, I could hear him breathing, smell him too, a sharp and physical stink above the familiar, soft and rotting odour of the river. He had uneven teeth, not very white, with marked canines, and a beard that was grey, going silver, probably there to cover a double chin. Not tall, but hefty like a rugby player. Plain black jacket, plain black jeans. Millions of men like him everywhere, though the police weren't much impressed when I told them that. As I tried to explain in the interview room, I was sure I'd recognise him if he turned up again. It was describing what he looked like that was difficult. The thing that stood out most was a big badge on his jacket, shiny, circular, grey, like the blank pupil of a giant glass eye. Never seen anything like it. "Hello, Ginger. You're as pretty as a picture," he said, sounding dead pleased with himself. Straight off, I hurried to pack up my brushes and paint and snap the easel shut. "Have you tried out one of them new toys they're all talking about?" "What's it called?" "Don't know what you mean, mate." My hands were shaking as I struggled to get everything back into the holdall. For some reason, running didn't seem an option. "Got to go." "Course you know what I mean. Everyone's talking about it. Reeler, that's it, reeler. Ever seen one, my little ginger beauty?" "Don't have money for that sort of stuff. Dad works in Coldblow." "Oh." His laugh was low and slow and liquid. And there, in that always active imagination of mine, I found a name for him. Mr. Chuckles. "Trapped in Coldblow. Just a slave, then?" Scared as I felt, I wasn't taking that. "He's not a slave, none of us are, never will be." Mr. Chuckles laughed again, and I wondered what was bad inside him to make a slopping noise like that. "Wrong there, girl. Poor but happy, poor but free. None of that works. If you're trapped in Coldblow, that's just what you are, a slave on a chain. Never going to break that either. Never going to get away." His hand fell on my shoulder and he squeezed so hard I could feel his fingers grip my bones. Then he winked and leered, said something about how he'd never had a ginger. I couldn't stop staring at that shiny badge on his jacket. "Be good now, eh? That way it won't hurt." I wasn't good. It did hurt. They never found him, even though I spent a long afternoon in an interview room trying to answer questions that seemed mostly about me making things up. It made a couple of paragraphs on our town bit on Facebook, the only thing that replaced our now dead local paper. A minor assault victim to go down in the statistics. As one of the officers who turned up pointed out, it wasn't as if he had time to get very physical, largely because I kept fighting, screaming, scratching, trying to do as much harm to him as he wanted to inflict on me. Then a bloke with a dog came along and started shouting. All that noise and yapping chased him off. The uniformed policewoman taking notes said being alone like that by the river wasn't the smartest thing in the circumstances. On balance, maybe I was lucky. Next time, don't expect there'll be a stranger and a barky dog to save my bacon. If push comes to shove, she added, maybe the best thing to do is give in and hope he doesn't murder you into the bargain. Or better still, stay indoors and never put yourself at risk to begin with. Even out there in broad daylight, tempting fate, that was. Self-isolation, you see, was the safest way to be, even when Dr. COVID wasn't doing his rounds. Facebook never mentioned my name. Didn't matter. That place was full of gossip, some true, some not. Hard to tell the difference. Still, Pretty much all of Soulswell knew Charlotte Mackintosh, the solitary ginger kid, got almost raped out trying to paint a picture. Was all round our virtual little town in a matter of hours, or so it seemed. I didn't go out with my easel and brushes after that. Didn't go out much at all, except to school, and there I had no choice. After the police shrugged their shoulders and gave up, they got a doctor in, a counsellor too. Mum cried for a while, then took refuge in the gin. Dad looked shocked and lost for words. Guilty too, because if he hadn't been so obsessed with putting a new padlock on the shed, a place no one else was allowed, he'd have been with me down the river. He always blamed himself for everything. While Rick was Rick, embarrassed, uncomfortable, puzzled. He couldn't work out what had started all that mad shrieking that got in the way of the telly. Why couldn't I just get over it? Didn't I know when it was time to move on? They fed me pills, checked me over to see I wasn't carrying anything nasty from Mr. Chuckles, then sent me back to school. 2 days in, after English, I found a note stuck on my locker. Always knew you were a tart, ginger nut. When you up for a shag next? After class the next Monday, three lads caught me on the way home, dragged me into the cemetery by the church, and pushed me hard up against the wall of the sexton's wooden hut. Jimmy Parker, a pock-marked thug whose dad was in jail for burglary, spat at the ground and grunted, "Use a condom, then. This bloke what had you?" "No one had me," I said, as calmly as I could, with his elbow up against my throat. "Mucky bitch." That was Dave Fowler, another year 12, a lanky lad with bony fists he liked to use, but only when one of his mates was around. "We're going to dig a hole for losers. Drop you in there one by one." Mickey Jones I'd known since play school. His mum had died a druggie a few years before, so he lived with his dad along with a bunch of semi-feral dogs that terrorised everyone on the street. He wasn't the worst Markham had to offer, but he was the sort they called easily led. So he joined in by groping me, said my tits were no bigger than a pair of fried eggs, and how he was allowed to do this now. It was his right, since Charlie Mackintosh was just a slag who hung around the river in the faint hope of getting off with any bloke who happened to be passing. Just then, Mel Parks came past, pushing her bike. I could tell from the sudden look of alarm on their faces they knew that wasn't good. Mel was my one friend in Markham Free School. We'd been close ever since we sat next to each other that first day. I was the youngest in the year, Mel the oldest, which meant that she quickly decided the timid, different girl next to her was the little sister she never had. With her short, blonde hair, always tidy, fashionable clothes, slim figure, a bit of makeup but never too much, she seemed older than 17. They'd brought her father in as management at Coldblow just before she started school. They were from somewhere down south. They'd wanted her to go to some private boarding school, not Markham Free, with all its problems. She insisted on local, and what Mel wanted, Mel got. If you were only going to have one friend at school, then Mel was the sort you'd pray for. Quick as a flash, she dropped her bike and came over, elbowing her way between them until she stood between me and the hut. "Wasn't doing nothing," Jimmy Parker bleated. "Just having a laugh." "Lying bastard," Mel snapped at him. Then she prodded a fingernail in his cheek and laughed when he squealed at that. "Get out of here, you lot, or I'll have you in front of Tyler in the morning." "He don't give a bugger about the likes of her," Fowler shot back. "No one does, weird old ginger slag." Tyler was the headmaster of Markham Free, a weak, kindly man who walked around the corridors making pleasant remarks to all he met, then fleeing if anyone answered back with a question. Discipline was not his forte. At the turn of the year, the teachers had taken to wearing body cameras. A few even carried cans of pepper spray, and let it be known they weren't afraid to use them. Tyler didn't say a word about that either. "You scummy little cowards!" Mel Parks had a temper on her that could light a wet bonfire. "Don't you ever call my mate that, slag!" Fowler said again. "That's what she is, don't belong here!" Mel stayed right in front of me, arms folded, shaking her head. "Is this who you three are, then? Big, brave lads picking on a girl?" Hop it, Mel, Parker said, nodding at the road. This isn't about you. None of your business. She's more my business than you lot'll ever be. Now piss off! Mel dropped her arms then, and none of them spotted it coming. She grabbed Parker so hard by the crotch he started screaming all falsetto as she twisted and yanked at him, while the other two retreated, looking shocked. The yelling went on for what seemed like a minute. I stayed hard against the hut, shaking, wishing I was back in my room, drawing, reading, doing anything, so long as I was on my own and safe. When Mel let go, Parker squawked all hurt. That weren't called for, you could have damaged me. She cackled at him like a witch from Shakespeare. Oh, poor Jimmy, I do apologise. Well, boys, what's it going to be? Both of us, or nothing. How brave are you feeling now? She nudged me with her elbow. We're ready, aren't we? I mumbled yes and looked at the three of them, wondering what had happened. Kids I'd grown up with, not liked, not hurt, not done anything to offend except be there, a square peg in the spare, round hole they'd come to feel was theirs and theirs alone. Parker shrugged a defeated shrug. They'd lost the moment Mel turned up and knew it. No worry. There'll be another time. She won't be with her girlfriend then. He winked. And when I saw that, I saw Mr. Chuckles in him too. Now will you? We watched the three of them wander back to the road, nudging each other, making filthy remarks, waving their fingers. All the gestures boys like that felt so funny. You need to tell Tyler, Mel said as they vanished round the corner. Get it on the record. Why, he won't do anything. He'll warn them. They're on cautions already. Carry on like that and they'll get kicked out. Then get a menial job in Coldblow, where they'd be even closer. There were no threats, no sanctions really, no place you could hide from the likes of Jimmy Parker and his mates for good. I hugged her and said, you're my best friend, my guardian angel. Mel wrinkled her nose and chortled. You don't need one, Charlie. You're stronger than you think. Besides, it's nothing you wouldn't do for me. That wasn't true, and we both knew it. I was a coward. Confrontations were something I hated and always would. Shrink away, hide, make yourself invisible. That was the way I'd learned to survive. Simon's taking me out for a Chinese tonight if you want to come. Simon was Mel's new boyfriend, a man, really. He worked in Coldblow. Something to do with computers. Quite a bit older, it seemed. Got things to do at home, I said, and realised Mel knew that was a lie. I'll be fine. Have fun, and thanks. I never told Dad about Jimmy Parker and his mates. He was still seething about what had happened down by the river. One more bit of trouble, especially from kids I knew and could name, and he might have done something about it. After he left Barleycroft, he'd moved into a tiny rented studio in an old miner's terrace in town. Dad was watching every penny. It wasn't much of a place, but I was happy to visit him. Stay over sometimes too. The next time I went, there was a question I had to ask. Growing up, Soleswell hadn't seemed so bad. It seemed a quieter place back when I was little. Not richer nor poorer either, just more settled. Then it started to change. People became more grumpy, more resentful of those who had things they fancied, more belligerent to anyone who was different, black, foreign, gay, anything really. The plague seemed to set the seal on everyone's misery. It wasn't the same place. Or maybe it was, and I'd just been dumb. So I asked him out loud, Dad, did things change, or was it just we see people now for what they really are? Until the lockdown and Mr. Chuckles came along, he was the happiest man I'd ever known. Later, when I thought about him, it was always his eyes I saw first, bright, wide, twinkling with joy, and then his smile. He could turn pretty much anything into a joke when I was little. Not now. Mum's attitude to what had happened in the woods was simple. Block it out. Pretend it didn't happen. Don't think about it too much, because if you did, you'd only kick yourself for going there in the first place, or for a stupid thing like painting some birds. But I didn't blame myself, not for one second. I blamed Mr. Chuckles, hated him, even though I knew that was a petty, childish thing to do. Sometimes I dreamed about taking a knife to him and doing things I didn't like to think about. Not that I told anyone. They'd only force more pills on me. More talks with a doctor if I did. That night in his room, when I came out with the question that had been bothering me for so long, he'd looked me in the face, and I knew straight off I'd jabbed at a delicate, painful nerve. "Oh, Charlie," he said, folding his long arms, "and to think there's folk out there who reckon you're a bit young, a bit naive and quiet." I loved the gentle twang of his voice. It was musical, sonorous. Maybe that was something Scottish in him. "But they don't know you. I do. Inside that head." He rubbed his finger against my hair. "There's a smart old mind at work. But hear me out, please. Sometimes the brightest people miss things. The world's always been like this. Maybe it always will be. I guess they never noticed. They certainly never asked me. If they had, I'd have told them. The devil never sleeps. He hides until he's called." Straight off, I hated the fact I'd made him miserable. "People will wake up, won't they? They'll know what's right and what's wrong, find some kindness, a bit of respect and generosity inside them. Because that's who we are, really." "Some will," he said. "Trouble is, they'll be the ones who never saw what was really there in the first place, how dark it was, how hidden. So they'll probably put that idea back where it came from and never do a thing." I felt lost for words. After a little while, he said, "Always remember this. The sun only rises if you make it. The light can't pierce the dark if you don't flip the switch." His brawny arms went round my shoulders. "When you're ready, you need to be brave and go out in that world again. We'll find you some birds you've never seen before, and that'll open your eyes. Don't worry, I'll be there. Every step you take." He was crying by then, and so was I. "Tell you what, love, I'll get you a nice birthday present." "My birthday's not till Saturday." "True, but I'm telling you what you're getting now, so you know. A reeler." There was Mr. Chuckles in my head again. Not that I let on. "I don't know what they are." "Time to find out, then. Everyone wants one." "Not me." "It might help you see things, and also," he beamed, "they're part of the company, Coblo. I get one on the cheap." "Not cheap enough, no arguing," he said, wagging a long finger. "With Dad, there never was." That Saturday, I walked round to his place and found him grinning like a kid at Christmas, desperate for me to open the present he'd bought. I was willing to indulge him, even if I half knew I'd be begging him to take the thing for himself before long. Maybe it was that tracing app we all had to have on our phones now, but the only piece of electronics I had was a cheap pay-as-you-go Samsung I hardly used. Plastic and screens were never my thing. I liked objects, stuff you could touch and feel. The pens and pencils and bits of paper I kept on the desk in my room all had their own character. Some I liked more than others. When I wore down a favourite crayon so much it was too short to be any good, I felt a kind of loss throwing it in the bin. It lived, it scribbled, it described the world I was seeing, and did all that faithfully until my busy fingers sent the thing to its crayon grave. Dad, like most men, I suspect, was a bit gadget-obsessed, not that it was an indulgence he could afford. I sat down on the bed in his room and watched, amused, as he took the whole reeler kit out for me to admire. It came in a paper globe, one of those Chinese lanterns people set on fire to float off into the sky, as if the things would just rot down into nothing, not kill birds or choke sheep the way the nature people said. The ridged sides were covered with colourful paintings of bright yellow sandy beaches, towering snow-capped mountains, clear blue oceans and famous sights. The Taj Mahal, the Eiffel Tower, New York, all places that, if you grew up in Soulswell, you knew you'd never get to see, especially since the plague left us all poorer than ever. I'd never had a passport in my life and saw no reason to have one. Foreign holidays had never been for people like us. But now, thanks to the technological generosity of the Reeler Corporation, part of the international conglomerate that also happened to own Coldblow, you could go anywhere without setting foot outside the house. We lived in a small world again, or a big one, depending which way you looked at it. Whatever, a world that seemed mostly owned by companies so enormous, people lost track of them, never quite knowing where anything came from anymore. Inside the box was a candle to send off the lantern and mark your ascent into the great and limitless expanses of Reeler World. Beneath that was a single sheet of paper with basic instructions, a barcode to download the app, and a free few games. Then a pair of Reeler spectacles, cheap, heavy black plastic frames, and old-fashioned. They looked like sunglasses, but they weren't. The lenses held two screens that showed you what the specs were looking at, with any additions Reeler's software wanted to add along the way. An array of six tiny cameras ran round the frame all the way back to your ears. There was a microphone and a speaker built into each of the arms. You also got the gamepad, a black plastic controller with red toggles and a touchpad in the middle. Running your finger around and waggling the sticks took you all over your chosen world if you needed to go somewhere quickly and couldn't be bothered to move yourself by nodding your head. Then the star of the show, the hood. It looked like one of those cloth helmets old-fashioned pilots used to wear in the cartoons, except with a massive eyepiece at the front that ran halfway down your cheeks and ended under your nose. For all that, it was comfortable. Some people wore theirs for hours on end. It was made out of a brown felt like moleskin, a colour they called taupe, with an elasticated band around the back to keep it in place. A camera at the front captured whatever you were looking at. Two ultra-high-def screens in Reeler vision, rested just in front of your eyes, bigger, better versions of the ones in the specs. Close up, you didn't see them as two. It was like a pair of binoculars, just one picture, three-dimensional at times. A pair of speakers sat over your ears with a subwoofer, whatever that was, built into the plastic strap around your head. The hood was lightproof and pretty much soundproof, which meant that, once inside, you couldn't see or hear anything unless Reeler let it through. The camera moved with your head, so it felt very natural, as if you'd just grown an extra set of eyes. The logo was tattooed in all the logical places, on the bridge of the glasses, in scarlet cotton on the front of the hood, across the gamepad. It was a hand-drawn image of a man with wide, excited eyes and a gaping mouth, amazed as the top of his head lifted off and all manner of things, mostly odd and exclamatory punctuation marks, came out of his skull. There was a motto engraved in gold on the hood and the arms of the glasses. We do not describe the world we see. We see the world we describe. Which to my inner, sceptical voice translated as, this miserable hole you're in right now is no more real than the wonderful one we're going to give you. It's up to you, just take your pick. Not that I said that aloud. First things first, Dad set up my account with the barcode, then, before I could stop him, picked out an ID, Queen Charlie 08, and scribbled it on a bit of paper he put back in the package. It says not to use your real name. He scratched his greying ginger hair, thinking, oh yeah, sorry, I did this in a bit of a rush. Want me to use another one? Nah, it doesn't matter. You need to choose your own password, though. It always makes you pick a new one after the first go. Funny that, I thought. It sounded as if he knew how to use it already. You do it. He shook his head and said, oh no, you'll never remember it then. You have to pick one for yourself. It's important. Barleycroft. Don't be daft, that's where you live. I don't have any secrets or any money. If someone breaks into my virtual memory, they'll find it's very empty. For now, maybe, but who knows about tomorrow. This thing's supposed to be there for life. Pictures, videos, your calendar, your address book, your shopping list, diary. Everything goes in there. Bad enough having a spy in your phone. I didn't like that one bit. Not sure I want everything going in there. Besides, I don't much need a calendar. And as for an address book, it'd have three names in it at most. Also, I can't afford shopping. Won't always be like that, I promise. I got the mock serious dad stare. You could always pick one that reminds you of me. I'm vain like that. He wasn't vain at all, but he had a point. Can I have grumpy dad? No, it's disrespectful and untrue. Also, you need a number in there and some punctuation. Think of something personal, something that you'll always remember but no one else would know. I struggled with that. Then it came, a warm and welcome memory. Christmas when I was tiny. That bike he bought, second-hand naturally, now rusting down the garden in the weeds. How old was I when you got me the toddler trike? Dasher. It had a reindeer on its side. I'd named it from a Christmas song at play school. You were three. Quite an awkward child, if I'm honest, and not much has changed. Okay, it's Dasher 3. He thought for a moment, then scribbled it on the little pad he always kept in his pocket. You're not supposed to do that, write them down. It's backup in case you lose things, now. I'd pretty much decided I was going to hand him the reeler as soon as I could without looking rude. Then I let him slip that hood over my head, adjust the straps at the back, and watch the introductory run-through, my induction as a reeler cadet. The few free games it came with were crippled, so once you got hooked, you'd have to hand over money to keep playing. But the heart of it was Reeler World, the place most people went. This was what the name suggested. The world outside, but with some very clever Reeler additions. The place you could explore almost as if you were actually there. A place I knew I'd never see any other way. And it was free. A tour of that hogged most of the introduction, all 20 minutes of it, with lots of noise, a bit of music, and this really caught my interest, a quick tour of the Louvre Museum in the company of a virtual guide dressed up like the Mona Lisa. When it was over, he was seated on the edge of his bed, wearing the realer specs that came with the set. Except he wasn't Dad at all. He was a very lifelike, smiley bear, brown fur, beady eyes and all. I giggled. The bear giggled and put a giant paw to his mouth. Dad said, "Fire up, Spix." I could only assume he'd been reading the instructions at work. The picture inside the hood flashed, and the view went from me straight to the specs he was wearing. I was now looking at myself sitting down, a bear just like him. That was the avatar he'd picked for Queen Charlie 08, one of the basic ones. First time out, I'd been seeing him through the camera on my hood, second time the other way round from his specs to mine. Since the hood and the specs were paired to the same account, I was, effectively, looking at myself. The specs became a satellite version of the hood I could wear outside whenever I wanted. That was just for starters. If I wore the hood or the specs and met another reeler playing the game, what I saw was their avatar, not who they were, even if they were walking down the street. There wasn't an override either. The only way you could find out who they really were was to take the gear off altogether, and every reeler from cadet to expert would tell you there was no greater sin than doing that without warning anyone else. People could complain. Do it too much, and they might even throw you off the system. Your privacy matters, the instructions said, and so does that of your fellow reelers. Enough, Dad, your turn now. Half an hour he spent messing inside the hood. I had to shake him out of it and point to the clock. The night shift began in 40 minutes. He was still grinning as he shuffled on his blue work suit, the uniform for the warehouse. Like it then? There was an unspoken question in his voice. It was asking, does this go a little way to help you forget Mr. Chuckles? Is it just possible that Reeler World might help you get back into the proper one, the place that you have to live in day to day? It's amazing, fantastic, thanks. You shouldn't have. It's a lot of money. I kissed his bristly cheek and got that dad smell back, sweat and soap, with it the warmth of love. My girl's worth it. She's worth lots more. Don't need things, just you and Mum. He glanced at me then, a bit guilty, and frowned. Any chance you'll ever come home? There, I said it. Rick's in Barleycroft, love. Your mother seems happy enough. Happier than she was with me. That's not true. Well, I don't know. I don't want to upset anyone. You wouldn't. He shrugged. I'm always here when you need me. You go back to taking walks, eh? How about it? With those specs, you can just wander down the lane for starters. Snap some birds for me while I'm working. I'll watch them when I come home. Should be some interesting visitors coming soon. See if Mel or someone wants to come. So that was what this was all about. My solitary existence. How I didn't want to set foot outdoors, especially since that encounter down the river. Sooner or later you'll have to come out of your shell, Charlie. Not far. Try bird-watching down the lane to begin with. Send me some pictures. That thing'll do video, too. Team up with your pals. How about I team up with you? He hesitated. When I can, but really, I'm your dad. You need friends your own age. You've got to get out there again. Climb back on that horse. Tell you what. I picked up the hood, determined to make him happy. You keep the specs for a while and work out how to use them. I'll hang on to this, then you teach me. I can beam in from the hood sometime, or whatever they call it. Pear, that's the right name, I think. Pear, then, deal? He laughed out loud. Just trying to get some more of my time, aren't you? The thought never crossed my mind. Doesn't need to, girlie. He kissed my hair and put his arm around my shoulders. I belong to you, and you belong to me. That's how it'll always be. He tapped the specs. But thanks. Be a few days what with the shifts I've got, but I'll sort them. And then, he raised an eyebrow, pretending to be cross, they're yours. To go out and explore this world of ours. Find out what it's all about. Make sure you tell me when you do. I'm sure I haven't a clue what's going on anymore. I kissed him back and buttoned up his blue cotton work suit all the way to the neck. There was a breeze that night, quite cold. He walked me home, arm round my shoulders. Owls were hooting in more than wood, and a fox somewhere began crying horribly, like a baby being strangled. They make that noise, Dad said as I shivered, listening to it. Doesn't mean a thing. When I got back, Rick was on his own watching the football, a can of beer perched on his belly, laughing at the fact Mum had been given an extra night shift at work. I never understood the way he turned up. It all seemed to happen very quickly one weekend, not long after Dad had left. There'd been no shouting, no fighting. They all knew one another from work. The way Mum approached things, it almost seemed as if it was nothing more than a change in personnel. Rick was the nagging sort. Tidied your room yet? Can't you do your own washing? How about a part-time job? He seemed to feel he had the run of the place from day one. There was nowhere off limits, not the attic even. I found him up there once, rummaging through the tea chests where we kept old toys and dusty books, just looking to see if there was anything useful, he said. I could have told him without all that fuss. There wasn't. Got a reeler? He asked when he saw the packaging. Birthday present. Mum had given me a card with £5 inside before she set off for Coldblow. Rick said that was from both of them. He hadn't signed it, naturally. Version 1. It'll be gone in 6 months. Always wait for version 3. I'm sure you're right, Rick. Real waste of money if your dad forked out for that. Everyone in Coldblow's going to get one for free. Hoods, lapel cameras, reelers built into watches, phones, everything. They'll stitch them under our skin before long. All to do with performance and statistics. They'll know exactly where you are, how hard you work, how many times you go to the bog. Got government clearance, apparently, because they've offered to do all the virus tracking alongside for free. A laugh. People think countries are run by governments. Bollocks. It's corporations that own us now. He finished the beer, belched, then got up suddenly and grabbed the lantern from my hand. You haven't sent up your balloon, have you? I don't really like those things. Got to do that, bad luck otherwise. He tipped the contents of the package out onto the settee and ran his fingers over them as if they were his already. Where's the specs? I lost them already. Typical, girls. Useless at stuff that matters. Before I could say another thing, he was jamming the candle into place as he reached for his lighter. Rick, I followed him through the kitchen into the garden. Can we just put it in the bin? Those things are really awful for the environment.
Those things are really awful for the environment. Who gives a...
I do. They kill birds and stuff. It's just a paper balloon. Stop being pathetic. I'm not pathetic. I just don't...
No wonder no one likes you at school.
Close by the shed, the night smelling of diesel and the faintest scent of a few flowers that had sprung up through the long grass and weeds. Rick lit the candle then, after the flame took, pushing the thing into the air. A whiff of fuel and burning paper wafted down. I watched the lantern rise towards a horned moon, thinking, so this is your ascent into the great and limitless expanse of realer world.
What's your realer name then?
Can't remember, Dad did it for me. I've got it written down somewhere. He grinned, pulling something out of his pocket and went, ta-da! The bit of paper with my ID was among all the packaging he'd poured out onto the settee. Rick was good at spotting stuff you didn't ever want him to see.
Just checking. Queen Charlie 08, nice, I guess.
I grabbed the bit of paper from him.
Can you manage to remember it now?
Not sure real is my kind of thing.
What is your kind of thing?
He walked up and came close, eyes glittering, beer on his breath. I found myself remembering Mr. Chuckles and his clawing fingers. As if he knew, Rick reached out, grinning, and touched my hair just briefly.
16 years old, and you never go near a boy or a girl. Only bit of fun you've had with some old bloke down by the river, what a waste. When I was your age...
Wasn't fun. Don't ever call it that.
Maybe if you weren't so bloody uptight, it would have been.
The night sky seemed to be tugging like a magnet, dragging me towards the emptiness. I need to do some reading, I lied, then went indoors, scooped up the bits of the reeler from the settee, and ran upstairs. He watched every step. The room was tiny, but the only one I'd ever known. There was space in the cupboard where I kept my books and drawing stuff. The hood and the gamepad went on the bottom shelf next to some old paperbacks. Then I closed the door and pushed the bed hard up against it. Downstairs, the telly got louder. It was his way of answering back. The pit used to be Soulswell's grubby, pumping heart. Markham Free School had pictures on the walls from those days to remind us where we came from. Men with filthy faces, pickaxes over their shoulders, steel helmets with lamps cocked to one side as they walked away from the mine, grinning for all they were worth. Which wasn't a lot for most folk, not that they ever knew it. Behind was a gigantic wheel called a headstock, with a cage that went deep down into the ground. In some places, the government had started letting companies reopen mines, mostly with robots doing the digging. The black stuff wasn't supposed to be dirty anymore, and anything that could make up for expensive imports was welcome. Global warming seemed to be a shade passé now, however strange the weather became. Self-sufficiency in food, in fuel, in national stamina was the watchword for the day. There was no second coming for coal blow, though. Most of the worthwhile coal got drilled out before the place was closed. And besides, no one would dare to tell the global giant behind the warehouse it had to up sticks and move elsewhere. They were one of the few big employers we had. With the virus hiding out somewhere, no one dared hope it was truly gone for good. We were all grateful for what we could get. From time to time, the school would bring in retired pitmen, bent old pensioners with feeble voices, who'd talk about those days. It was everyone's legacy after all, and every piece of heritage required its own well-documented tragedy, a piece of history that pinpointed where a place came from, explained a bit of what it became, and recorded the sacrifices made on the community's behalf. Soulswell's happened one winter more than 60 years ago. It was in the middle of the afternoon shift, when more men than usual were underground. Fire in the hole, someone yelled, too late. 42 miners were trapped for 3 days. 37 of them died, choked by fumes and dust, burned to death in furious flames, mangled by collapsing tunnels and workings. There was a memorial statue to them not far from the gates to the warehouse that stood over what was still, for some, a grave. Those weather-beaten figures and the grassy hill of slag was all that was left from the colliery days.
For a while, the Soleswell Pit tragedy was on the news. TV crews outside the gates, reporters trying to find bereaved wives and parents and ask them how they felt, the way reporters do. Then the pit went back to business. The press vanished. Being a dutiful student, I'd read a bunch of library cuttings from the time, news stories, sermons in the churches, speeches by sympathetic politicians. They all said the same thing. We will never forget you. But they did. Soleswell was dead easy to leave behind once you'd gone down the road. All over the north there were places that had gone clean out of people's minds, their stories trampled into coal dust or the rusty iron filings of closed steel mills as another generation turned up, scratching their heads, thinking, not a lot I can do about that now, is there? I'd tried hard to listen to those old miners when they came in, though most of the class just fidgeted and yawned. Only one of them talked directly about the tragedy, and he ended up in tears, embarrassed as anything. The rest just went on about how very different their world was back then, different in a good way. Men banding together to go down into a nightmare of dust and dark and danger none of us could begin to imagine, then wandering off to the working men's club to get dead drunk while their women stayed at home, looked after the kids, washed their filthy togs, and put supper in the oven. They never actually called it the good old days, but if you listened carefully, you got the impression they missed something from back then, and it wasn't just the fact they had the money and the thirst to sink pints and pints of cheap beer. Maybe it was their youth. Maybe that's what happened when you got old. A sort of bitterness swamped you when you looked around and thought of all the things you never did and realised it was all too late. Just once, I tried to ask one of them if life was really better. The old miner looked me up and down, a caustic expression on his wrinkled face, and said, "You wouldn't understand." A few weeks later, they brought him back for the second part of the project. This time round, I got Mel Parks to ask the same question, since she was pretty and had a fetching smile, no freckles, no head of wayward red hair. I thought it might be an interesting experiment. The old man didn't give Mel quite such a filthy look, her only crime being she was young. Instead, he just shrugged and grunted. "It was for me and the lads." 60 years before, Soleswell was a village clustered round the pit. Pretty much everyone dependent on the mine one way or another. From the old pictures, Sheffield Road wasn't much more than a lane. Not the busy highway it had become. Lorries running to and fro, night and day, to the warehouse. Back then, hardly anyone owned a car, and most people lived in council houses. Now those council houses were private homes, mortgaged to the hilt or rented, and anyone lucky enough to have a half-decent job drove miles and miles to work. Half of them didn't know their neighbours, even though they were living squashed up together in tiny terraced boxes on estates that seemed to keep spreading across the fields year by year, like giant cowpats on fresh grass. Mum had inherited Barleycroft from her father, a miner, naturally, who'd bought it with some money he'd won on the pools. It was a two-up, two-down detached farmworker's cottage along a private track, just far enough from the main road for the drone of lorries to be little more than a hum. The nearest neighbour was a quarter of a mile away. The garden was a rough lawn and an abandoned vegetable plot now Dad had gone. Dasher, the second-hand trike he'd bought me when I was tiny, newly immortalised in a password, had sat rusting in the corner beside the clothesline for years. Beyond the shed, there was a wild patch of brambles, an elder bush by the back fence, and a tiny pond that got ducks and moorhens from time to time, and frogs and newts in spring and summer. If I looked left out of the bedroom window, I saw fields of wheat or barley or rape, depending which farmer had rented them for the season. To the right, that big green slag heap, and beyond the high wire security fences, the dun rooftops of the warehouse, so big they looked like fresh ploughed fields of hard, bare earth rising out of the ground. Up the hill was the low and leafy shape of Morthen Wood, past that the Markham Council estate in all its glory. Still, Mum owned the house, didn't rent it, didn't owe a penny on it. Dad always kept us out of debt. Better go without than borrow. In the dismal economic wake of the pandemic, We were one of the few families around who weren't in hock to the banks, or worse, the loan sharks. I used to ride a bike the mile to school, but after two of them got nicked, I knew who it was, but moaning was more trouble than it was worth. I gave up and walked instead. Our private track to the main road was potholes, earth and bricks, tall hedges on both sides, hawthorn, field maple and blackthorn. Walking on my own was okay, except in winter when it was dark and my imagination ran wild from time to time. I had to go past that memorial to those dead miners, three figures looking busy, as if for battle, helmets on, pickaxes over their shoulder, all covered in lichen and bird crap, hands to their eyes, looking towards the big green hill of the slag heap. Then there was the traffic, and half the road to school didn't even have a pavement. You had to take care in Soleswell. Keep your eyes peeled. It wasn't hard to understand why people wanted to escape, even into a land of make-believe and other people's dreams. Not long after my birthday, a Wednesday evening during that long and airless summer, I found myself bored enough to wonder whether to take out the reeler and give it a proper go. Dad's toy, as I still thought of it, was sitting upstairs untouched. The hood and the gamepad, that is, he had the specs. Instead, I pulled an old book off the shelf, a kiddie story, mainly pictures.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.